FEAC Working Group, which comprises members of the federal, provincial, and broader sport and fitness community, including Sport Matters. My name is Deborah Gaswitz, and I'm the President and CEO of CIRC, Canada's Sport Information Resource Centre. Welcome to the webinar about the Canadian Sport Policy 2.0 implementation. Canadians across the country helped to develop the Canadian Sport Policy 2.0, and today we thank you for joining us as we continue the awareness of what's commonly referred to as CSP 2.0. It's great to have so many joining us on this webinar. In particular, we're pleased to have the Honourable Minister of State, Val Gasal, leading us in our discussion. Minister Gasal is a tireless champion of sport in Canada and one of the most prolific users of new technology and social media to help connect and share Canadian successes in sport. Welcome, Minister Gasal.
Hello everyone. As Canada's Sports Minister, I'm delighted to welcome you to today's webinar. Let me begin by thanking CIRC for hosting this session. It is an innovative way to use technology to help stakeholders in our sport community share information about the work they're doing to advance physical activity and healthy living in Canada. In 2012, I joined my provincial and territorial colleagues responsible for sport in endorsing the new Canadian sport policy. One feature I really like about the policy is it recognizes all the ways in which sport is practiced throughout Canada. I can relate to this because I was involved with the recreational sport back in my hometown, and now high-performance sport is my priority as federal sports minister. Another important aspect of the policy is its recognition of the role sport can play in building strong and healthy communities. I had a great discussion recently with members of Canadian Parks and Recreation Association on how best to promote sport and physical activity for children and youth in schools. The Canadian Sport Policy offers a way for which the experts in different sectors to pool their expertise and tackle major issues together instead of separately. That is why I'm particularly delighted with today's webinar, which promotes best practices being used throughout Canada since the implementation of the Canadian Sport Policy. The three panelists you will hear come from different parts of the country, and each one of them has an interesting story of success that we can all learn from. I hope that all of us will continue to share and learn from others who are making a difference in promoting the goals of the policy in their community, province, or at the national level. I look forward to continuing to work with everyone in Canada's sports community on the important work of promoting sport in Canada and implementing the Canadian sport policy. Enjoy the session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister Gasal. And with those inspiring words, let's continue our knowledge exchange as we prepare to learn from each other by sharing successful programs from across the country that support various objectives of the Canadian sport policy. We're going to learn about enhancing capacity through an innovative sport funding approach in Quebec, educating on physical literacy and engaging Nova Scotian communities using Canadian Sport for Life, and developing safe and welcoming sport communities in Manitoba using Respect in Sport. Throughout the presentation, participants are invited to type in any questions you may have for our presenters in the Q&A box on the bottom right of your screen. We'll collect them and we'll post them then at the end of each of their presentations. So let's begin with the ever-important building the business capacity within sport. Marc Brolet will describe an innovative and very successful funding model developed in Quebec to help provincial sport organizations. Marc is the director of Placement Sport, focusing on increasing and diversifying sport federation revenues. Marc has more than 20 years in communication and marketing experience, as well as a dozen years in charitable organization management. Marc, over to you.
Thank you. And to start off, I'd just like to briefly, and I can't assume that people know about Sports Quebec, so I'm just going to briefly talk about the organization here. So our organization is a nonprofit organization responsible for the promotion of sports development in Quebec, and we work on the four different levels of sports. So we encourage participation through initiation, recreation, competition, and excellence. We also play a leading role in the organization of major events such as the Quebec Games. We also have a big role in the Jeux de la Francophonie as well to support the all the logistics for the Quebec representation on those games. We also have an annual sports gala and numerous fundraising events. We manage the National Coaching Certification Program and the Multi-Sport Training Program for officials. Our membership, our constituents, are 66 sports federations in the province, representing more than 90 different sports, with a total of about 900,000 members. Now, to talk about the program that I manage, sorry, I skipped a slide here. Plasma Sport was launched in April 2012 with an initial budget of $2 million. So that was increased in the second year and for the next 4 years. So the project will be ending in March 2017. It was based on a similar project. Actually, we sort of were inspired by the one that was started in culture in 2005 that was called Mécénat Plasma Culture, which was based on the same functioning but which is a bit different. So we have three principal components to the program. For the first 2 years, we started by giving the organizations a fundraising support allowance. Then by the size and structure and budget of each sports federation, we established a percentage of gift matching to the federations. So it was either 50 to 300% of gift matching. So if a federation that was matched at 300% went to get $100 in fundraising, the government would match it with 300% more, $300 more, for a total of $400. So it's a very stimulating program. The other thing that was very important was that it had to include a 10 to 30% of total earned in an endowment fund. So that funding, that 10 to 30% of the bulk envelope of the matching plus the gift, was to be set aside for 10 years. They could take advantage of the interest on that fund, but couldn't take any of that fund for the next 10 years. So that's frozen. So the perspective of that is really to think long term about the funding of the sports federations. So it's funded by the Ministère de l'Éducation, du Loisir et du Sport of Québec. And it's basically the idea between the 50 and 300% that I was just talking about was the ones that have the most limited resources were the ones that had the higher matching and the lowest endowment percentage. Now, the principle behind that is to better develop their sport and better serve their local populations. There's four objectives to the program. So it's basically revenue increase for them, revenue diversification, learning fundraising techniques, and have a long-term revenue vision through the creation of the endowment fund. I am overseen by a governance council, so whatever we do in the program is managed by a group of 10 people. Three of them are from the ministère. Others are either board members from Sport Québec or other people that are active in the sports community. There was three basic conditions to joining the program. We needed a signed agreement saying that they would adhere observe all the regulations of the program. We needed a board resolution, so we wanted the board of the sports federations to really be to take part of this by saying, yes, we will do that and we will abide by all the rules of Revenue Canada and how the program was developed. And also they needed to develop a case for support for their development. So they needed to see how they would invest that money in future development. So what the investments would be used and what kind of programs and development or functioning fees would be covered by the funding. After 2 years, just briefly, we'll give you a few numbers. 63 out of the 66 sport federations are fully registered and eligible for the program. 47 of them held fundraising activities last year to be matched in the program. 5 federations out of those created the philanthropic development committees, and this is very important to change the mindset and think of being able to engage the population in supporting financially the federations. $1.4 million was given in, as I mentioned earlier, support fundraising activities or staff, so that money needed to be invested in that development so that they could take advantage of the program. Here's a few more numbers. We have 9 fundraising training sessions that were given, either for half-day or full-day fundraising training sessions. $4.3 million were earned in gift matching. 32 endowment funds were created. I'm going to create another half dozen in the next session that we have, for a total of $800,000 that was deposited at the end of 2013. It's important to know that the $5,000 is a minimum requirement to open the fund to be managed, and they have access to the interest generally generated yearly, but they have access to the total fund accumulated at the end of the 10 years, as I mentioned earlier. Here's an important perspective from Sport Québec, because we used to receive, we have the Fonds Sport Québec, which has a charity number and is allowed to give charity receipts. So in 2011, we worked for 730 gifts, totally won $1.4 million, to 2013 for 3,200 gifts totaling $2.3 million. So the increase is really spectacular, and it's really driven by this program. In conclusion, after 2 years, the program is much appreciated, and as an example, I'll just give you one, and maybe later we can discuss in the questions. Triathlon Québec used the money to develop their initiation through primary school triathlon, so this is it was very interesting how they invested their money to develop that. And just the numbers are really incredible regarding the amount of money that was the fundraising efforts of the federations and how much money that growed, that was earned by them. There's obviously growing pains in setting out something like this. We have a few operational issues. We didn't expect to have this flow of transactions. Just the tax receipt issuings, but there's so many possibilities for mistakes and all of that. So we're ironing all those things out, and we're also trying to put in place tailored reporting and analysis for the fundraising efforts that are made, just to be able to pilot this and help them have even better results in the future. There's another growing pain is the outstanding balance to pay for the federations. We started with $150,000 matching fund maximum, and there's so many federations that already for the second year reached that total that we owe more that we actually have to manage. So that's a very good sign on one hand, but it also it's a bit preoccupation it's a preoccupation for the others. So the perpetuation of the program is a key issue, and obviously we'll be aiming for the perpetuation and just keep on going with this program. So we're already starting to crunch our numbers and to be able to make sure that we have a sustainability of this program in the future. So with that, I'd just like to leave with a quote by Winston Churchill that said, "We make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give." So most of you all have worked with volunteers and people that are generous in different forms in their life. But giving, and this has been my experience in the past 12 years, I think that I'm actually living something that's very enriching by helping the sports community get more money to fund its mission. That's it for me.
Mark, that was excellent. And I think it's always interesting when we can end up learning different funding opportunities, and especially in a situation where it's been as creative as you just described, because that's amazing, matching funds that are coming out. One of the questions we received was one that already was giving feedback, saying that obviously that it was a very interesting program, and did we know any other programs like this or in Quebec? Are you familiar with any other similar or coming funding programs in Quebec?
In Quebec, as I mentioned, there's Mécénat Placement Culture, so in the cultural sectors for theater and anything that has to do with the arts. So they have a similar program in Quebec, but outside of the province, I'm not aware of anything. I think that there might be something it being set aside or started up in Alberta, but I'm not sure, and I don't have anything definitive about that.
Excellent. And I think it's nice that we're seeing some programs being shared from Saskatchewan and others. And what we've done is we've just moved over a box so that other people could actually be entering in and sharing with the audience across the country. If you're familiar of other programs, now's a great chance to be able to add that to the list as well, sort of share all of the information. So I would invite people to put in if you know of other funding programs, and certainly to keep sharing all the pieces. I see that in Alberta there's also a development fund that is great to be sharing with it, which is the RUN, which is nice. So Alberta has a development fund run through the Alberta Sport Connection, limited to provincial sport, but that's very interesting, because good to be able to see that. So thanks very much, Gary. There's another question, Matt, which says, I wonder, were the matching funds new money into the system from government, or was the funding instead from program funding?
It's actually, there's two sides to that question. The new money from the government, yes, it is new money for the gift matching part and the fundraising support allowance. But some of the organizations already had fundraising events, and they just multiplied the money through running that in the program. Now, and that's not necessarily new fundraising money for the organizations. So what we're trying to do now is to make them think and in a development perspective, and just to be able to widen their development on the fundraising side.
And that's excellent. It's interesting to see, and again, creativity as it's coming forward. I know when I was chatting with Bob with Sport Matters, we were referring to similar programs perhaps with CETA, where, again, it was trying to come up with matching programs and matching funding that was coming forward. And I also notice, as we're both looking, that there's other great programs being mentioned, such as the Quest for Gold Enhanced Coaching Funds in Ontario, or the Community Fund in Ontario, the Support for Sport, which is coming in as the Nova Scotia, with a great link. So all of these we'll be able to share with everybody as well, which is wonderful, and the High Performance Coach Capacity Grant, which is, these are all really good initiatives for us to be able to follow up. So at the very end, we'll be opening it up for other opportunities to be sharing, and I think this is an excellent exchange. So with that as the concept for funding, and actually we're going to hold on just a sec, because I'm noticing the McConnell Family Foundation, which we know has actually done quite a bit in the past. They've done quite a bit of investment through for development for sport. We've seen them investing into quite a few of the Aboriginal communities. We've seen quite a bit of investment coming forward, as well as the Alberta Sport Connection Donation Fund, which assists athletes and not-for-profit sport and recreation organizations in obtaining financial support. So it's really interesting, and it's really good, because it is showing that people are out there and helping out.
If I could add something here at the end, I see RBC and the McConnell family, the matching percentage, it works for these fundings. So if the Sport Federation would actually, through RBC, get some money there, they can run it through the program and get that gift match as well to the percentage established for them.
Yeah, no, and that's interesting. That's very good. Cool. Okay, well, I think with that, which has actually been a very interesting and a great beginning to today's panel of sharing a great program and equally letting people know about other programs, I think this is a nice segue. So thank you ever so much, Mark. Because another important Canadian sport policy objective is to ensure that Canadians have the fundamental skills, knowledge, and attitudes to participate in organized and unorganized sport. Nova Scotia is actively trying to engage their sport leaders and to reinforce the importance of physical literacy. And as a result, they have implemented several great programs using Canadian Sport for Life. Here to tell us about what and how they are achieving success is Amy Walsh. Amy is the Director of Sport Development for Sport Nova Scotia, with a sport background as an athlete, coach, and administrator. And she now works with provincial sport organizations in the area of program creation and implementation. So Amy, now it's over to you.
Thanks, Deborah. Similar to Sport Quebec, Sport Nova Scotia is a non-government, non-profit federation of over 55 provincial sport governing bodies, which we call PSOs, for provincial sport organizations. Collectively, we are a voice for more than 160,000 member Nova Scotians. Sport Nova Scotia promotes the benefit of health, personal development, and achievement for all participants. Sport Nova Scotia provides support, direction, and leadership to its member organizations in the delivery of quality sport opportunities to Nova Scotians. In part due to the leadership of Jamie Ferguson, who is our CEO and a member on the committee that was involved in the process of the creation of the Canadian Sport Policy 2.0, the Canadian Sport Policy influences much of the work that we do here at Sport Nova Scotia. Sport Nova Scotia not only fully supports the Canadian Sport Policy, but we work with provincial sport organizations and other partners in order to incorporate the policy into our programming, funding frameworks, and overall culture of our organization. One example of how we are currently implementing the Canadian Sport Policy is through our federal-provincial bilateral initiative. The bilateral initiative called Creating Community Connections is an innovative and cooperative program that allows improved access for sport groups across the province to become engaged in the Canadian sports system. The plan supports the directives of the Canadian Sport Policy by providing capacity in every region of our province to assist and recruit community-based organizations with a focus on underrepresented populations. As part of this initiative, as you'll see on the slide, there's the photo of our six community sport development coordinators. We're hired and they're housed within the six regional offices of the province's Active Living branch. And you can see a tiny map there. I have a map on my next slide, is how our province is broken down into regions. And they're responsible to work with community sport organizations affiliated with PSOs, but as well with schools, municipalities, and community groups to identify, collaborate, and support the continuation of sustainable sport opportunities in the region. As we know, a majority of sport participation takes place at the community level, club, school, municipal rec, etc. Canadian Sport for Life, it's known as CS4L to most of us, aims to improve the quality of sport being delivered throughout the country. Logically, through this program, much of our attention and effort needs to be focused on making change at the community level. CS4L implementation requires a lot of building awareness and facilitating collaboration and educating and empowering leaders. The sport coordinators, the CS4L champions, play an intricate role in that community implementation. The Canadian Sport for Life framework, based on the long-term athlete development model, known as LTAD, is comprehensive and therefore needs to be permeated in all aspects of their work. However, in the last 18 months, we collectively put a focus on three specific areas. Those areas are recreation leader forums, community sport development summits, and provincial implementation plan. I'm just going to speak in a little more detail regarding these three focus areas. There's a better picture of our province divided into the regions on this slide. So the Recreation Leader Forums are a one-day event offered in each of the six regions of the province. The event aimed to bring together municipal recreation professionals, physical activity leaders, as well as other stakeholders using the CS4L framework to engage in collaboration, education, and discussion. The main goals of this one-day recreation forum was to increase the knowledge of the participants around CS4L, physical literacy and program alignment as it relates to sport and how they and how it relates to their professional roles within their community. It also aimed to identify potential collaboration opportunities between sport development stakeholders, to identify and celebrate successful practices and stories of community sport groups as they relate to CSRL, as well to identify actions and next steps for participants once they return to their professional roles within their communities. In order to reach these goals, the themes during these forums focus a lot around Canadian sport policy, CSRL, and specifically physical literacy. Some presentations included building enhanced collaboration between sport and recreation, becoming a CSRL community, and where to go from here, and community sport group success stories around LTAD alignment, next steps to advance CSRL in the communities. A lot of our resources and information came from the Canadian Sport for Life website, as well as members of the CSRL leadership team. And also a huge piece of the Recreation Forum days was breakout groups of these recreation professionals in order for them to share success stories and talk about next steps and how they could work together. Some of the outcomes after the Recreation Forum, it was really just a starting point that enhanced the understanding and knowledge around the Canadian Sport for Life movement and the sport coordinator's role. It really provided the sport coordinators a platform to build upon. This momentum was achieved because they targeted the recreation leaders and have maintained the importance of conversations and actions that need to take place with these leaders who ultimately have influence over programs and overall direction. Some examples of some of the outcomes from the recreation forums have been overall increased knowledge and understanding of CSRL and LTAD, the importance of physical literacy, staff training, and programs such as fundamental movement skills, run, jump, throw, tumble bugs, and even potential policies around mandatory training. Program alignment with recreation departments in programs such as Active Start, Rally Cap, Tumble Bugs, and more programs that address physical literacy in the early stages, as well as ensuring coaches have access to training and education. The next phase after all the recreation forums were completed was the focus number two, which was the community sports summits. So this was a one-day event targeted to board executive members of community sport organizations, club coaches and technical directors, and community sport leaders. The event offered support, resources, and funding information and tools needed to empower sport leaders who are striving to offer quality programs in alignment with the CSRL movement in Canada. The overall goals of the community sport development or community sport summits include an overview and insight into CSRL, discussions and connections of its advantages and what it can offer to community sport groups. It linked clubs and organizations to potential funding partners and opportunities. It provided facilitated sessions aimed at equipping boards with tools, information, expertise, and resources to operate more effectively, and also bring together sport leaders within communities to enhance communication networking and connection to resources and support within their own region. In order to reach these goals, presentations in these one-day sport summits focused around how to create quality sport programming through the implementation of Canadian Sport for Life principles. Presentations included CSRL, Physical Literacy 101, what does CSRL look like in your community, organizational effectiveness, planning for success, community coaching and effectiveness, that connection to NCCP, LTD alignment, and funding opportunities. The overall outcome we've seen is a more engaged community sport champions, increased awareness of LTD, and better aligned programs and outcomes. The communication between Sport Nova Scotia, PSOs, and CSOs is significantly enhanced following the summit. Especially that connection to the CSO to PSOs has been greatly enhanced. CSOs feel more supported, connected, and knowledgeable regarding funding support and partnership support. multi-partnership approaches and multi-departmental communications among all settings, such as school, recreation, sport, and health, has become the norm. More importantly, the summit educated a large number of stakeholders about CSRL and the importance of quality in sport delivery, and has led to many consultations exploring how CSOs can create a plan focused on the doing the right thing at the right stages. A few examples of outcomes that have occurred since the summit include purchasing of LTAD-aligned equipment, introducing new sports such as progressive tennis, indoor kayaking, future links golf, CSOs reaching out to work with other sports to combine resources and identify opportunities, and sports coming together to approach us in partnership. In summary, the results have been really great, and these are just a few numbers. For the Recreation Forum, we were able to educate over 100 recreation professionals around CSRL. So far, with the Community Sports Summits, we've educated over 360 community sport leaders. We've had over 45 CSRL presentations and information sessions to various groups and stakeholders. And I've actually updated 45 NCCP fundamental movement skills were completed in the last year. And just to compare, in our province in 2011, only one course was held. And since we've started on this journey around knowledge mobilization and the importance of educating our leaders with training, it's gone up to 46 in 1 year. And we are still in the planning phase of 5 more sports summits to occur in various parts of the province. The only significant challenge we ran into during this process was that we were slightly ahead of the game. Recreation directors and some community sport organizations didn't clearly identify that CSRL was a priority. So as a result, over the last 6 months, in collaboration with the Government of Nova Scotia, the Active Living Branch, Recreation Nova Scotia, we've worked towards the creation of a provincial implementation plan. Our focus is a CSRL-aligned sport and physical activity programming and practices with a primary focus on the first 3 stages of LTAD. So it's a plan that just goes until 2016. And the 3 main priority areas are knowledge mobilization, which will be educating leaders in organizations, municipalities, and parents about CSRL. LTAD alignment, assisting organizations and municipalities to make programming changes to align with LTAD, and support leadership development and training. And lastly, collaboration, facilitate opportunities for organizations and sectors to work together around CSRL. In summary, this project supports the directives of the Canadian Sport Policy by providing capacity in every region of our province to assist recreation leaders and community-based organizations to deliver quality sport programs. In August 2013, federal, provincial, territorial ministers responsible for sport, physical activity, and recreation approved a list of priorities for collaborative action over the period of 2012 to 2017. Of the 11 priorities, 3 of those are an area of focus in this project. Those 3 areas were promote implementation of CSRL or equivalent programming in sport and related sectors, 2, support introduction to sport programming with a focus of traditionally underrepresented or marginalized populations, and 3, collaborate with sports sector stakeholders to identify priorities and strategies to improve capacity in the sports system. So that's my presentation. Thank you for listening. And perhaps if I could pose a question, I was just wondering if anyone else might be using CSRL or overall LTAD frameworks to assist and guide your work.
Actually, it's a really interesting question. I think that's a totally relevant and seems to follow through with some of the questions that we're seeing across the country as to whether or not they've been using CSRL. Amy, looks like you're getting actually some really positive indicators here on the CSRL front. Actually, and to your point, sort of almost following it out with so many people making reference to it, this is also a good opportunity for, if people are using CSRL, perhaps for them to be even typing in some of the examples in the open space below in that exchange of different programs that you might be using CS4L for. And while people are typing in some examples, Amy, I have a couple of questions for you that have come in that perhaps we can be answering. And one of them was just, and I think you may have referred to it, but how are you able to measure your program's success? Is there anything else you might want to add to that?
I think a big piece of it is both the recreation forums and the community sports summits are really just the starting point. And we've really focused on the evaluation component and really sort of listening to those who have attended and really trying to take the feedback that they've given us, and really that is the next phase. So it's really just the starting point. And so I think to one piece where we would be able to say, identify some successes is through the bilateral, these community sport development coordinators also have access to grant money. So they have used this grant money towards projects that are LTAD aligned and are focusing on physical literacy. And they've come from groups that have attended these recreation forums or sports summits. So they've worked with these groups to develop a plan, and then they've been able to fund them in a way that sort of gives them the capacity to become more aligned with LTAD.
Excellent. That makes a lot of sense. So moving on to one of our other questions, so obviously that, you know, this is great news to hear about the improved relationships between the PSO and the community. Do you have any stories or information that you could share that describe the improved partnerships?
Sure. One example might be there was a community sport development summit in Cape Breton, which is the far end of our province, and there was a number of sailing groups that attended that, and they felt quite disconnected to not only themselves, who within the different clubs, but as well to the PSO. So what, and perhaps if I could pose a question that occurred after the summit, was that the PSO and the sport coordinator collaborated, and they were able to have a day of planning with all of those clubs within that area of the province, and they developed a regional plan in collaboration with the PSO. And so it was a great outcome of the day, so not only collaboration within the region, but then kind of working with the PSO to really work together in that region.
That's a great example. It's always nice when you can see how relevant it is. One of the other questions is, can people from out of province participate in your CS4L and fundamental movement courses? Like, are there any e-learning materials?
For any of the NCCP fundamental movement skills, yes, they can.
Excellent. That's perfect. And so when first mobilizing the community sport leaders within the sport associations, what steps were taken to encourage participation in the sport summits?
I think it was about creating what we focused on was a strong committee, and that committee that planned these recreation forums and planned had someone that sort of represented all aspects of sport. So it was a leader in the school environment, it would be a leader in the community sport environment, it would be a recreation director. So it really sort of listened to the needs of the community, and it really had all those key people on the committee that then were able to make sure on the agenda of the day was really something that would be relevant to those groups to get them there. So some of the things that we used to get some individuals there was around funding, was around board governance, was around kind of planning. A lot of things where a lot of groups I know struggle with and can really relate to. And then through that, we were able to then, when we got them there, was really educate them around Canadian Sport for Life and around long-term athlete development and the importance of sort of athlete-centered, participant-centered programming.
That's perfect, because I think that's a logical next step. One last question, and then we're going to move on to our Respect and Sport with Manitoba. And certainly it's, you know, appreciating the program. And quick question, do you plan to run any of these programs again or do a next step?
We're still continuing on with the sport summit, and then we are hoping within 12 months to do a provincial conference. So that is one of our areas now, and then that will hopefully tie everything together.
Well, that's good. That'll be one of those where it actually would be interesting to get some of that update and perhaps even share, you know, some of those next steps and next procedures. I've received a couple questions just asking about where people are putting down a lot of the different examples of programs or different links. Absolutely. We're collecting all of the different information pieces, and we'll hope to be sharing that following the webinar so that we'll compile the resources so everybody can benefit and be able to return back and look at some of these excellent examples, because we've had a really nice list of different examples of CS4L as well as different funding programs. So with that in mind, we're now going to move on to the next step, wherein sport isn't good sport if it doesn't provide a safe and welcoming environment. The policy has as one of its fundamental principles that all sport programs should be values-based and designed to increase ethical conduct and reduce unethical behavior. Our third panelist, coming from Sport Manitoba, is their Director of Coaching, Greg Gunther. Greg's sport administration and coaching experience began with volleyball, including positions with Volleyball Manitoba and the Team Canada Volleyball Centre. Greg continues to coach school and club volleyball and is a member of the Coaching Association of Canada Board of Directors. Manitoba believes so strongly in the importance of sport free from bullying, harassment, etc., that it has mandated a provincial program called Respect in Sport. So with that, Greg, over to you to tell us about your program.
Thanks, Deborah. Very interesting call, and it's really great to hear some of the great programs that are taking place across Canada. So I applaud CIRC for creating this opportunity. I would really like to talk about a program you may be familiar with. Whoops, I may have jumped the slide there. It's our Respect in Sport online training program, and just some thoughts about the tie-in to the Canadian sport policy, and really looking at a dynamic and innovative culture that promotes and celebrates participation and excellence in sport. And we want to continue to support and develop volunteers and coaches within the sport system. And this is a program we feel pretty strongly aligns with the Canadian sport policy, specifically under the policy values of safety, commitment, personal development, inclusion and accessibility, and absolutely a respectful, fair play, and ethical behavior within sport. The policy principles as well align very well with the Respect in Sport program in terms of values-based, inclusive, collaborative, and I'll share some of the ways in which we have been collaborative, intentional, effective, and really sustainable. There's probably a good number of folks on the call that are aware of the Respect in Sport program and are likely aware of the story of Sheldon Kennedy and the challenge he had in his coming through the sport system. And ultimately, this program was built by Sheldon and his team, and it was really designed to build and support volunteer and coach development in a positive and proactive manner. So taking, you know, really a negative thing that took place in Sheldon's life and trying to build a program that he feels is really important to help develop and shape the future of ensuring sport is a safe and welcoming environment for Canadian youth. So in terms of Manitoba specifically, and I have included some links on the PowerPoint, and I'd welcome you to go to them because there's more detailed information you can get about the program, and certainly when we went into our commitment, we knew there would be a lot of frequently asked questions, and that's something that we developed throughout the pilot program of launching the program. So in Manitoba, it is required training by any coach that's registered with a PSO in Manitoba. And this online program specifically deals with bullying, harassment, and abuse. And what a coach and a volunteer creating an appropriate environment, but also empowering volunteers and coaches and anyone in the sports system to understand their role when they are witness to bullying, harassment, and abuse. We mandated it through Sport Manitoba, and specifically we work through the PSO network, our provincial sport organizations. And I think I've noticed some folks from Saskatchewan on the line as well, and Saskatchewan has also recently mandated Respect in Sport in their province. We launched in December 1, 2006, and we set a target of required training by December 2007. We wanted to give a fairly long period of time for the different provincial sport organizations to meet their typical season timelines to ensure they could actually implement this in a reasonable fashion. The course itself is 2.5 to 3 hours online. There's 6 30-minute modules. It is available in both French and English, and it also allows you to log in and log out. So as a parent, as a volunteer coach, you can imagine your life is busy. So if you've got an hour one evening that you can sit at the course and go through it, it will always allow you to log back in to where you ended your last session. Very much focused on empowering and educating leaders within the sport community. And it's really a part of our overall risk management program for sport in Manitoba. In terms of success stories, absolutely, you know, we are committed in terms of funding to ensure that any coach can access the training at no cost, so there is no burden on a volunteer coach in terms of paying for the cost. We've managed to use the database in a very positive way. It's allowed us to communicate with coaches and develop our coaching e-newsletter. So Once a coach enters Respect in Sport, they have the option to accept the newsletter, and we have a pretty positive response on people accepting the communication piece, but they do have the option to opt out. We've also been able to build sponsorship agreements. When we initially launched the program, Manitoba Chicken Producers was our lead sponsor for Respect in Sport, and most recently Manitoba Liquor and Lotteries. It was a relatively smooth transition in terms of working with the PSOs and ensuring they were able to mandate and have their membership comply with the training. We developed a fairly good marketing and communication strategy with our marketing and communications unit to ensure they had all the tools to communicate with their membership, ensuring coaches would move forward to complete the training. A lot of sports have actually extended the training beyond just the coaches and now require their managers and other volunteers within their organization to take the training. Absolutely, I'm sure some people are wondering how many coaches or sport volunteers have taken the training. There's a breakdown on the slide of how many each year we put through the program. So we're just shy of 40,000 coaches having completed the training online. So it's pretty impressive. The other thing I should add is the training is also accessible via dial-up, which meets some of the needs in coaches or volunteers that may live in outlying regions where high-speed internet isn't accessible. Some of the other advantages, I mean, it is absolutely an engaging and simple to understand online training program, so it definitely meets a broad spectrum. We have many schools that call us and ask if they're youth leaders in some of their physical education or youth leadership programs can access the training, so we do have a lot of high school students that will take the training as well. There are many resources linked, and a coach can log in back to the Respect in Sport program whenever they need to access different links and handouts. We see it as a complement to the NCCP training that already exists. And with the new professional development and certification maintenance policy mandated through the National Coaching Certification Program, our hope is that the Respect in Sport program will be recognized as a PD credit, and I think it's very positive that that will happen. And again, I would say it's complementary to the Make Ethical Decisions and Empower Plus program. We have full database tracking. Our provincial sport organizations can work with the Respect in Sport staff, you know, to ensure that they have regular updates on their database, and whenever there's been a question or a challenge, maybe someone saying they did complete, they're always able to find where that coach is in the system. The last benefit I want to talk about is really been very important, and I'm sure working in sport, you've all received that difficult phone call, that call where, you know, it may be dealing with a harassment abuse situation or perhaps something else that's walking on that fine line of do you need to involve the police or a lawyer. Those are always difficult calls to take, and we still get those calls, but now we have an agreement with the Red Cross support line where our sport members, our volunteers, our coaches, athletes, educators can call the confidential Red Cross support line, and they can take that issue specific to an expert counselor that has access to resources, but also knowledge and expertise around many, many different topics. And what we're finding is the people that go to the Red Cross support line leave there with an action plan, once again, understanding or perhaps reaffirming what they think they need to do to deal with an issue that they're currently facing. We do get quarterly reports from Red Cross support line, so we know the types of calls that are coming in and whether, you know, they've just been simply provided with some resource information or whether it's an issue that perhaps had to move on to the police. The other benefit is Bruce, our counselor at the Red Cross support line, will come into Manitoba 2 times a year and deliver workshops based on a topic we feel is important or our provincial sport organizations and club organizations need to talk about. And as you all know, bullying and hazing have been huge in terms of in the media, and Bruce is an expert in that area, and he's been able to come in and do some excellent workshops with athletes, club organizations, and our provincial sport organizations. So that's been a real benefit for us. I'll end off there and just leave the slide up on the survey results. Each coach completes a survey upon finishing the Respect in Sport online training, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Greg, this is excellent, and I think, as you can tell, there's quite a bit of interest across the country in it. I mean, this is a very important topic. And so I'm going to start with some of the questions that are coming in right now, and we'll share them going forward. So one of them would be, would this mandatory training include coaches working in the school environment, and are teacher coaches registered with a PSO?
That's a really good question. In Manitoba, we have many school divisions, and it would be by happenstance if a coach in a school system is registered with a PSO. So if they're involved coaching that sport in a club capacity or provincial team capacity, they would likely be a member. But in Manitoba, school sports coaches are not required to be members of their sport-specific organization. We have had one of our largest school divisions mandate Respect in Sport training for every coach in their school division. And we certainly applaud them for taking that action, but it's not something we're able to mandate to each of the school divisions.
So when you're referring to your mandated, so how is this mandated requirement actually enforced for all of your coaches?
Well, with our provincial sport organizations, it's a condition of funding that they ensure their coaches have completed the Respect in Sport training program. So we can do spot audits, but you know they are actually very diligent in terms of ensuring their coaches complete that. And I can just say for myself, when I was coaching my son in soccer, I was required to show that I had my coaching card for Winnipeg Youth Soccer Association, and I did not receive my card until I completed my Respect in Sport training and my NCCP training.
So what is the cost for Sport Manitoba to access the resources? And is it a one-time fee and or are there costs for annual updates?
Yeah, the cost is, because it, you know, we are dealing with the corporation, the cost is something that's negotiated by Sport Manitoba with the Respect Group, Inc. So I don't know if I'm in a position to share our cost, but we do pay an annual fee in our agreement, and it ensures that we have no cap on the number of coaches or volunteers that take the training. So it's been very positive, and again, we've had many organizations contact us and ask to access the training, and we're very very willing and able to do that.
And so, do the coaches need to take the course each year or just once?
Yeah. The training is required, and we initially set out a 5-year recertification program. The back end of the database is being restructured right now for the operating system, which will allow us to begin implementing our 5-year recertification program. And so part of that is the Respect Group, Inc. will actually be able to message coaches directly to ensure that they know that their time is coming up where they need to recertify. And so with the recertification, you know, obviously they take the feedback that they get from coaches and users and make alterations to the program along the way. So we are actually just waiting to begin that recertification process. So 5 years is what we set out as our timeline.
Okay, so then that seems fair enough as it's keeping it going. So other than increasing numbers of coaches that have completed the program, what are the measurable results that you have seen since inception, and where might Sport Manitoba be heading with respect to mandatory parent programming in this area?
That's a really good question. Well, Respect Group had a survey and research study completed by PrevNet in 2009. Which really gave us some very good feedback. And this is a really good question because that is part of Canadian sport policy in terms of measuring the effectiveness of the program. The lowest rating we would have received on any of the research was a 73% positive or favorable response to a question, with the highest being 88.4% in terms of, and that one specifically was, I would recommend this program to another coach or activity leader. So I think Respect Group Incorporated plans on continuing the user survey and research, and for us that's been very positive. The other thing that, you know, in terms of measurable is the reports that we get from Red Cross support line, and the fact that we, again, a spin-off benefit of the Respect in Sport program is that we have that resource available that is so incredibly valuable for a coach or volunteer that's dealing with a difficult situation. And so those reports really, you know, emphasize the need to continue that support.
Thanks, Greg. And I think that actually is probably a fabulous question for us to use as a wrap-up right now, being very sensitive to everybody's time. And as we're now at 1 o'clock, it's been very interesting. Following the wrap-up, we will take it off lecture mode, so all of the presenters will stick around. So if anybody does want to just ask questions, we'll be able to follow up right after that. So at this point, on behalf of the SEAC Working Group and all the Canadians wanting good sport in Canada that encourage fun, safety, excellence, commitment, inclusion and accessibility, personal development, and respect, fair play, and ethical behavior, thank you for your continued support, and we'll continue to engage Canadians in building a strong and active Canadian sport policy. Once again, we thank you for joining us today. We hope we will see you in November when we learn about other programs being implemented that support our Canadian sport policy across the country. So thank you to everybody, and this has been an excellent session.